Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. Dustin Schubert for plaintiffs David Hamilton and Jay Ka. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes of my time for rebuttal. Your Honors, this shareholder matter presents the classic case of a company's executives and officers lying to the public about key business matters while the board of directors does nothing and lets them get away with it. Simply put, the board was not doing its job. Even worse, as reflected in Mr. Hamilton's complaint, AMD's board of directors knew that the company was making false and misleading statements about a key product offering.
Mr. Schubert, it might help for you to distinguish between the sealed complaint and the unsealed complaint or the public complaint when you're talking about it.
With respect to what happened at the district court, 25 paragraphs were disregarded by Judge Rogers.
25 of those, paragraphs of what?
Of plaintiff's unsealed complaint. The sealed version sealed 6 of those paragraphs. 19 were filed in open court. They were subject to a protective order in the defendant's mind, but they were not subject to sealing. So as reflected in Mr. Hamilton's unsealed complaint, the one that includes the 25 allegations, plaintiffs present that the company and its board of directors knew that AMD was making false and misleading statements about the Llano product offering. The complaint does this by including detailed facts showing that the company and member of its board of directors routinely and regularly received internal reports with all sorts of negative information about the Llano at relevant times. Now, these allegations in the sealed version of the complaint are based upon voluminous internal AMD documents that the company gave to Mr. Hamilton during the course of his case. The district court, however, never considered any of these key allegations. Of the 25 paragraphs, none in the sealed version and none in the public version. Instead, the district court here and the judge disregarded these 25 paragraphs, resulting in the improper dismissal of a highly meritorious case at the pleading stage. That decision must be reversed. With my time, I'd like to address 2 points that we raised in our briefs. The first is that Mr. Hamilton's unsealed version of the complaint, the one that has the 25 paragraphs, with all reasonable inferences drawn in his favor, as required by the Ninth Circuit, affirmatively demonstrates that a pre-litigation demand on AMD's board was excused as futile. And the second is that confidentiality agreements and protective orders must be interpreted using common sense, that is, connecting up their prohibitions to their purposes. The district court here failed to apply that critical analysis, requiring reversal.
So you're saying the judge was wrong in disregarding these paragraphs?
Correct. Whether it's all of the 25 or the 19 or just the 19 that were in the public
version. Why was she wrong?
Sure. So the judge reached that decision based on her interpretation of Mr. Hamilton's agreement to a protective order that was entered in a different case. So it bears backing up one step. In June of 2015, about 6 weeks after Mr. Hamilton filed his complaint, he entered into a routine case management stipulation. It accomplished several things. For purposes of today, the one that's relevant is that under the terms of the case management stipulation, the defendants agreed to provide Mr. Hamilton with documents produced in the related securities fraud action, the Hatamian case. On the face of that stipulation, there were no usage restrictions. It didn't say that those documents could only be used for mediation. It didn't say that Mr. Hamilton couldn't use those documents in an amended complaint. All it did say was that the terms upon which the documents were subject to a confidentiality agreement. So fast forward 4.5 months, in which the defendants provided Mr. Hamilton and his counsel a one-page agreement to be bound by the protective order in this related Hatamian case. It's the securities fraud case. We executed that one-page agreement. We did it properly, we thought, for efficiency and expediency. With the benefit of hindsight, I think we would have done things differently. I think that's reflected in our briefs. What we should have done under the circumstances is taken the Northern District's model protective order, modified it for our case, the Hamilton case, negotiated with the defendants on confidentiality restrictions, signed it, presented it to Judge Rogers. She would have entered it, and we could have proceeded from there. What the district court did is it interpreted the literal terms of the Hatamian order and applied them to the Hamilton case. She said that the Hatamian order said that the documents that are subject to the confidentiality can only be used in this case, which meant, under the judge's construction, the Hatamian case. So even though Mr. Hamilton had the documents, He couldn't use them for any furtherance or purposes related to his case. He couldn't use them to settle the case. He couldn't use them to amend his complaint. If they were going to be used, they had to be used for the Hatamian case. On its face, that's an illogical result. That couldn't have been what the parties had intended at the moment they contracted. Mr. Hamilton is not a party to the Hatamian case. His shareholder derivative claims were never at issue in the Hatamian case, and his counsel, my firm, were never counsel of record in the Hatamian case. Based on the judge's construction, we couldn't use the documents for any purpose. That makes no sense. And under this circuit's law, the Go Video case, it commands that protective orders be interpreted with common sense. And we submit that instead of where the Hatamian protective order says Hatamian,
You couldn't have used them in the Hatamian case anyway because you weren't part of that case.
Sure. So, we're never parties of record, Your Honor.
So you're saying that the whole interpretation of the protective order just makes no sense?
Correct. It can't be reconciled with any common sense. And I think that's buttressed by there's no indication on the record anywhere that the parties intended to materially alter the terms of their case management stipulation. The case management stipulation didn't say that the documents could only be used for mediation. It didn't say that Mr. Hamilton couldn't amend his complaint. 4.5 months pass, and we enter this Hatamian, we sign an agreement to be bound by the Hatamian order, which the defendants argued convincingly to the district court judge, meant that it unwound that agreement. We submit that it's not a fair or just result under the circumstances because it results in the improper dismissal of Mr. Hamilton's case. Without the benefit of those documents, which we think are damning, and I'd like to address in substance, Mr. Hamilton doesn't satisfy the requisite pleading standards for shareholder derivative law. Those standards are exacting. We feel like the complaint as filed under seal easily passes that test, but without the benefit, we understand why the judge dismissed the case.
Go ahead.
So I'd like to talk about the documents a little bit. They present, in our view, a very damning picture of AMD's board of directors. They present contemporaneous knowledge that the board of directors knew there were adverse problems with Alano at the same time that the company's executives and officers were downplaying those adverse results or saying there was no problem whatsoever. And if I could, I'd like to direct the court to a couple of paragraphs in our amended complaint that I think are most indicative of those problems. So for one, I'd like to point the court to paragraphs 47 in our amended operative complaint, as well as paragraphs 60. So the first one, paragraph 47, is an April 18th, 2011 board report. The full board received it. And the board is receiving very damning information. And I can quote for a little bit, where it says that wafer output is significantly behind planned and that all operational metrics missing and trending in the wrong direction. That's bad news for AMD. Yet 3 days later, and this is on paragraph 48 of our complaint, the company is saying that there's no problem. Defendant Seifert is saying that the demand for the Lanos is strong, that it was adding to the company's momentum, and perhaps most damning, that the company had ample product available for the back-to-school cycle.
So, Mr. Schubert, your action is to get damages from the board of directors for the corporation, right?
Correct. That's the nature of shareholder derivative law. We allege that the board has damaged the company through its wrongful and bad faith conduct and therefore is liable back to the board. Here we're at the pleading stage. It's an element to be proven later on about the nature of damage and the substance. That's for a later day. At the pleading stage, our obligation under Rosenblum v. Pyatt, which is the leading Ninth Circuit law on demand futility in this circuit, is to establish with particularity only that a reasonable doubt exists that a majority of the board of directors faces a substantial likelihood of liability for their wrongful conduct. Again, their wrongful conduct is permitting the company or otherwise acquiescing to the company's federal securities law violations. It was lying, the executives and the officers of the company were lying to the public. The board of directors knew it, and they didn't do anything. They didn't reprimand any of the executives for their wrongful actions, and they didn't issue corrective disclosures to the public. And as a consequence of that, the company was sued for securities fraud. It ended up settling in that case for approximately $30 million, and we allege the company's been material damaged, and the board of directors should be accountable back to the company and pay those damages. Now, briefly again, with respect to the protective order, because that's why we're here today. It cannot be reconciled with any common sense, good faith interpretation. In the course of litigating this case, in our experience, we complied fully with the spirit and the thrust of that protective order. The thrust and the purposes of protective orders is to protect the company's sensitive and confidential information. We feel like we did that. So when we filed our amended complaint, we approached the defendants, said we were filing material that was designated confidential. Which of these portions do you think need to be sealed? We complied. When we filed our opposition to their motion to dismiss, we undertook the same exercise. At all material times during the case, we protected the confidential nature of AMD's documents. That's proper. We didn't dispute that. The question is what the purpose, whether a prohibition in the Hatamian order somehow prevented Mr. Hamilton from using those documents in his amended complaint. We submit that it didn't. Any reasoning, and we believe the judge Rogers' reasoning was quite tortured, but any reasoning which precluded Mr. Hamilton from relying on those documents is materially at odds with the party's intention at the time that they contracted for the receipt of those documents.
How about the Haw case?
Sure.
Your time is running out.
Sure. I'll address it briefly. I think it's adequately stated in our papers. There are two cases that are consolidated for purposes of appeal. Mr. Hamilton's theory on why a pre-litigation demand was excused is different than Mr. Hamilton's. Both are recognized under the law. Under Ha, he alleges that a majority of the board was not adequately disinterested in the nature of did not possess adequate disinterest. And he does that by alleging a couple different things. First, that four of the members of the 11-person board are governing persons, designated non-independent in the SEC filings. Four others are members of the audit committee, which has heightened duties for reporting and heightened duties for communicating truthfully to shareholders. What I'll say with respect to both cases is that they're intertwined. They were consolidated for purposes of appeal. At the district court level, there was one hearing on the motion to dismiss, one set of briefing schedule. Judge Rogers ordered the plaintiffs to file a joint brief. We feel like we're past the point where these cases can necessarily be intertwined. We feel, and it's based on our papers, that this court can and should resolve the demand futility analysis at this juncture.
She didn't require a consolidated complaint, though, did she?
She didn't require a consolidated complaint, and I think it's reflected in the docket sheet. She issued an order to show cause in connection with the motion to dismiss about why the cases shouldn't be consolidated. She asked for the parties' opinions, and I see that my time is running out. Plaintiffs Hamilton and Ha agreed the cases should be consolidated. AMD opposed. She ultimately ruled that she would rule on consolidation after resolving the motions to dismiss. And I'll save the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Okay. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the court, Jason Hecht for the appellees in both cases. I'm struck in listening to the explanation of the district court's order, which, you know, we think was a fairly straightforward and simple exercise of the district court's discretion on a few key issues, that we're sort of sending that through a Rube Goldberg machine in order to make a fairly simple, straightforward opinion seem as if there is complexity and reversible error here. So I'd like to try to address just two main points. The first is the district court's interpretation of its own protective order. So the district court clearly held, and there was discussion about
it. The district court didn't draft it, did it?
The district court modified the protective order. So the parties submitted the protective order.
What kind of modification did she do?
She made some modifications to the, I believe it was a paragraph regarding how parties should meet and confer about
the parties drafted the document, correct?
The parties drafted the document.
Submitted it to her.
And
she made a few changes.
And she made a few changes.
And she signed it.
That's right. And
what was the purpose of the protective order?
The purpose of the protective order, and it's...
Why did you want a protective order?
Two reasons. One, to protect against public disclosure of confidential information, and two, to ensure...
What was the confidential information?
So in the securities case, the product at issue is a commercially sensitive product that was, at the time the case commenced, still in development and... it involved agreements with a number of different suppliers, including AMD's customers, all of which involves, you know, fairly confidential.
Okay, so that's what you wanted to protect, then. So
that was one piece,
Other purpose was, there was two purposes for the protective order?
Correct, and that's the very first paragraph of the protective order, which is before the court. It's docket entry 33, exhibit A. The very first paragraph of the protective order says purposes and limitations, and it says Discovery in this action is likely to involve production of information for which protection from public disclosure and from use for any purpose other than prosecuting this litigation may be warranted. So that's right there on the first page of the protective order. There were two twin aims.
For any other purpose other than prosecuting this litigation?
Correct. So in other words, the goal was to ensure that when we produce information, number one, it's not disclosed publicly. Number two, it's not used for any other purpose other than prosecuting this litigation. And I think that's a common requirement, frankly, to put into these sorts of orders, because otherwise you end up in every discovery fight, you end up in disputes over, well, are we producing it in this litigation or that litigation? And the ability to understand this is the factual
so
record.
Was that, let me ask you this, was that protective order signed in the, what was it called, the Hartanian?
That was entered in the Hatamian case.
That protective order.
Correct. And then in the Hamilton case.
Was Hamilton a party to the Hatamian case?
No, Your Honor, he was not.
His counsel were not parties either?
That's right, but Mr. Hamilton's counsel signed with Exhibit A to the Hatamian protective order, mm-hmm. in which they agreed to be fully bound by that protective order, including all of its
what
terms.
What role could Hamilton play in the Hatamian case?
So Hamilton wasn't playing a role in the Hatamian case, but...
if you're saying to him, here you are, Hamilton, you can have these facts, and you can only use them in a case that you can't do anything about.
Well, no, that's not quite what we're saying, Your Honor. I think there's two points there. The first is they were receiving these documents, and keep in mind, a shareholder derivative claim, they're representing the company. So this is ostensibly a claim on behalf of the company.
Right.
And they had agreed in the case management stipulation that they were going to be invited to the mediation in the securities action. And they're there, essentially, as the company, right, to, you know, determine whether there's been harm caused to the company, what's the resolution going
by
to be.
By the board of directors.
Correct. And the settlement of that securities class action, it's a little bit of a strange alignment. When you're talking about settling a securities class action against the company, the derivative plaintiffs and the company at that moment in time are aligned. Everyone wants the smallest settlement possible. Everyone wants the best outcome for the company. And so the derivative plaintiffs, and this is fairly common the way these cases are done, you would have the shareholder derivative plaintiffs participate in the mediation of the securities class action because they are purporting to stand in the shoes of the company. And so one way, and if that case is able to resolve itself, the securities class action, perhaps the derivative case can be resolved. Perhaps there's been no harm, the parties will agree that there isn't really a claim. Lots of things can unfold from that point. But the point is, when you've got a shareholder derivative case, you've got the shareholder plaintiff saying, here I am standing in the shoes of the corporation, and they join us at the mediation, essentially in that role, where we represent the corporation, and they are, at least at this point, nominally representing the corporation in connection with the resolution of that litigation. And I think one other point here that I'll make, Your Honor, all of these arguments about why the protective order doesn't apply, they didn't raise with Judge Gonzalez-Rogers. So those are all appearing here in this court for the first time.
Let's move to the next stage. So everything, the settlement, they don't settle this case or whatever, part of that mediation.
Right.
Right? And they file an amended complaint in this case.
Correct.
And they add the 25 paragraphs, right?
That's right.
And then eventually there's a motion to dismiss. I thought that, and you can explain this to me, but so I thought it was that only six paragraphs remained under seal. Is that right?
So
that essentially you weren't objecting to the other 19.
That's right,
unless I misread the briefs.
No, that's right, Your Honor. I think we follow the guidance from this court in terms of what is appropriate to be sealed. And at that point, you're weighing the confidentiality of the information versus the public right to know. And so the suggestion that the only information that they can, that is warranting of protection is what meets this court's standard for sealing, essentially rewrites all of the protective orders in this district. And the protective order here is the model form. It rewrites everything to say you can use it however you want and put it on the public docket if you want. The only thing you can't do is publicly disclose it. And that collapses the protection of the orders, which go much further than what this court will allow to be sealed, with the very narrow set of material that this court would allow to be sealed.
Okay, so let me, so then Judge Rogers says, well, I'm not going to consider it anyway. That's essentially what she did, right?
Correct. And
and that's because of the way she interpreted, she gave it a strict, the protective order, a very strict reading.
That's right, Your Honor. And I, two points on that. The first is, again, this argument about information that was placed into the public domain. The information was placed into the public domain by a violation of the protective order. And so the argument here that they are entitled to, because we didn't move to seal something, they are entitled to use it, effectively says we can breach the protective order and put it on the docket and then go ahead and make free use of it. And the issue, the protective order itself says that a violation of the protective order does not cause material to lose its confidential protection. In other words, if material becomes publicly known by virtue of a violation of the order, it's still protected. And this is yet another argument that wasn't raised in the district court. All of these arguments about why the protective order here doesn't reach the conduct in this case were not made to the district court. I suspect I know why that's the case, but the argument below was generally we're allowed to use the information. There was never an argument that this particular provision or that particular provision of the protective order meant that the information couldn't be used.
Are you saying the protective order was different than the standards that of this court in terms of what can be public and not? Are you saying that there was a conflict between the secrecy involved in that and the standard here?
No, Your Honor. There's not a conflict, but the protective order protects a broader set of material in the sense that the protective order protects material that any party believes.
Why isn't that a conflict? If it protects more material than we allow, isn't that a conflict?
Well, so it doesn't protect it from. It's not a conflict with regard to what can be publicly disclosed. This court's order is about what information can be made public. Govern what information can be made public. On top of that, in addition, the parties can agree, and the court has here ordered additional restrictions on the use of that information. So, for example, I couldn't take information given to me and provide it to a competitor, right? That wouldn't be a violation of the court's rules on sealing, but it would be a violation of this order. And so,
if something can be made public, then how can you have any other restrictions? I mean, in the hypothetical you gave, if something is made public, how can you then say, oh, but you can't give it to a competitor? I mean, how can you say that?
So that assumes it's been made public lawfully. So the first person to put any of this information in the public domain was this plaintiff in this complaint. In other words, prior to that, it had never been in the public domain.
Why was it unlawful to put that in the public domain?
Well, the district court felt that it didn't comply with the terms of the protective order, and the protective order itself.
The terms of the protective order are different than the standards. I'm sorry, I'm confused.
Yeah, let me take a step back. The district court said, here's this order, here's what the documents are going to be exchanged for, and she was quite clear that the protective order placed limitations on what people could do with the documents. Once the documents were filed in the public record, there is a second question, which is separate and apart from whether people have complied with the protective order, what do we put under seal? And we addressed the question of sort of what can be put under seal, but there was still a threshold question of whether the plaintiffs complied with a judge's order about the use of the documents.
So, this protective order, it said Hamilton could only, having signed it, he was entitled to receive any discovery documents, right?
Correct.
And he could only use, and your understanding of the way you, and the way the district court read it, is that then he could only use them within the Hartanian litigation when he was not a party to that litigation?
So the
why would you even give him the discovery?
So the reason that you,
I mean, they would have gotten that if they had been litigating their case, they probably would have gotten the discovery. It would have been the same. You would have had a joint discovery.
Correct. And if you look at the stay agreement itself, the case management order itself, which is in the record at ER 152, the final whereas clause of that stipulation talks about why everything was joined together. It says, in light of defendant's agreement to provide plaintiffs with reasonably prompt access to discovery and to invite plaintiffs to participate in the mediation, the parties agree to stay this case. So that was, in that final whereas clause, that was the essence of the arrangement. We'll give you this information so that you can come to this mediation. You'll get a better sense of what
but
the claims are.
But you can't use it in your case.
Sure, because if this, well, you know, we're inviting you
well,
in.
You're invited, but you're still, you know, you're allowing them to use it in the mediation on behalf of their clients.
Well, their client's not really in that mediation. I mean, I think that's the point, right? You're coming to this mediation to understand your derivative case is based entirely on the existence of the securities action. So what we're doing is saying, we'll give you the discovery in the securities action. We'll invite you to the mediation of the securities action. You should come and get a better understanding of what the allegations and facts are in that case. And then, you know, if
and if it was possible, well, maybe we can settle the whole thing.
Maybe we could reach some agreement. Maybe we end up litigating the case. But the point is, none of that's here. And what the district court did, and all of this, I think the parties agree, is subject to abuse of discretion. What the district court did is said, I see the plain terms of the order. I don't find any ambiguity here. The district court noted, and we put this in a supplemental record, I think it's SER 3, the plaintiffs had the option to go back to the district court and say, Your Honor, this doesn't make sense. I didn't understand it this way. I'm not a receiving party. It's in the public domain. All of these arguments. And the district court and plaintiffs chose not to do that. They instead chose just to use the information. And we think Judge Gonzalez-Rogers was well within her discretion both to conclude that it was a violation of the order and that it was that she was permitted for several reasons not to consider those allegations.
Mr. Heck, there are two motions to take judicial notice. One is of the Hatamian protective order and the other is of the complaint in Wessels versus Reed. Mm-hmm. What's your position on those?
So we don't object to the taking of judicial notice in either of either of those documents. With regard to the complaint in Wessels, I think the only point I would add there is again that the Wessels complaint drew from the information that the Hamilton plaintiffs placed into the public domain. So the very first folks to place this protected information into the public domain were the Wessels plaintiffs. We at every stage of the litigation have been saying this information is protected by the, I see I'm running out of time.
Go ahead, I want to ask you one last question.
We have said the information is protected by the protective order. The district court said the same thing. And again, all of these arguments about it was used here, it was used there, we're not a receiving party, we didn't, none of those arguments were presented to the district court. And so we had lots of proceedings before the district court. We had briefing, we had argument. There was a second motion about extension of time. To not raise any of these arguments when the district court has said, I think you violated this order, and then appeal and say, oh gosh, the district court abused her discretion because she didn't look at all of these issues we never raised, it is a little inconsistent with the standard by which this court evaluates.
You didn't address, we've sort of passed over the other case, Haw.
Yes, Your Honor.
She didn't, there, they didn't rely on the...
They didn't rely. So there's no issue in Hahn, and I think
why aren't the allegations sufficient?
In Hahn, there's several reasons. The first, and again, that's a decision that's reviewed for abuse of discretion, and here, all they've done is simply identify...
Well, she dismissed the case as a matter of law, so you have to look at the allegations and ask whether or not, as a matter of law, does this allege a claim?
Correct, but even under this court's decision in Rosenblum, the dismissal of a shareholder derivative case for failure to allege demand futility is evaluated for abuse of discretion. So
I think there's some debate in our law about that.
There is, and I think you see the Rosenblum panel struggled with that a little bit and said, you know, but we remain bound by the notion that it is abuse of discretion, and that this court has subsequently several times said we will continue to review shareholder derivative dismissals only on this question of failure to plead demand futility for abuse of discretion. And I think the reason I take Your Honor's point there. That is different than most, you know, typical 12b6 motions. The difference is it's more akin to a case management issue where the judge is deciding who is going to control this litigation. Is it going to be one shareholder on behalf of the company, or is the company going to prosecute the case in its own name? And I think historically that's why abuse of discretion has been applied. But to get to Your Honor's question of the allegations, there's not any detail as to why the board would have been unable to fairly evaluate a demand. So, for example, in the Ha case, they note that I think it's 8 of AMD's directors are also directors of a subsidiary. It's not clear, you know, it's not clear to me how that would create any conflicting interest, much less one that would prevent them from considering fairly a demand to bring litigation against officers. Same thing, you know, they identify one director had an affiliation with Liberty Mutual, and one had with another entity. There's no suggestion in the papers about how these directors are, by any of those relationships, unable to fairly and impartially consider a demand to bring suit here. And if you look at, you know, we cited the Wynn case on this point. There was a substantial amount of interlocking and interpersonal relationships between the directors alleged in Wynn. Now, Wynn was Nevada law, but as this court noted, Nevada law follows Delaware, and so it's all the same. Even there, all of those interlocking relationships, where there was actually an explanation of what the potential conflict might be, was not sufficient to render the board unable to make a fair decision. And so here, I think we fall far short of the allegations in Wynn.
All right.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You might want to address the issue brought up by your learned colleague that all of the interpretive arguments that you're making as to the protective order were not put before Judge Rogers and therefore may be waived.
Sure, Judge Bay, I appreciate that. We did contest at the district court level. I don't think the briefing, plaintiff's opposition to the motion to dismiss is in the excerpt of record. We contested the application of the Hatamian order to our litigation. That's clear, I think, both from our opposition as well as from the transcript, which I believe is part of the record. We argued, and I think convincingly, that the judge disagreed, that applying the Hatamian order to our case and restricting it our usage of the document to the Hatamian order, the Hatamian case, which is not our case, was illogical and made no sense and was materially at odds with the parties' mutual understanding at the time of contracting. I would like to make one point with respect to a question that Judge Bea asked, I believe, and then I'm prepared to yield the remaining of my time unless there are questions. Both the case management stipulation and the Hatamian order, those are both contracts. This court reviews them de novo. And with respect to both of those documents, Mr. Hamilton and his counsel, my firm, we didn't draft them. They bear my opposing counsel's headers, their Latham and Watkins. To the extent their ambiguities as to the meaning or interpretation of those documents, the law holds that ambiguities should be resolved against the drafter and not Mr. Hamilton, who had no participation in drafting those documents, although he did sign them. Are there additional questions, Your Honors?
I don't think
so. Thank you. I yield the rest of my time.
Thank you. Thank you, counsel. The matter is submitted.